and this is going to be a very important lectures for the women's health. It's my pleasure to introduce the chairpersons of the evening. Our chairperson for the first session is Dr. Geeta Mendiratta. May I have Madam CV? Dr. Geeta Mendiratta is the editor of AOGD and she's the senior consultant, Institute of Obs and Gynae, Sir Gangaram Hospital, with special interest in urogyne. Madam has been the secretary of Delhi Menopause Society, vice president of ISOPARP Delhi chapter, organizing secretary of 11th World Congress and 19th Indian Conference of Reproductive and Childhood at New Delhi. She also had been editor in AOGD 2008-2009, ex-editor Narchi Delhi branch. Madam has delivered many, many guest lectures in state and national conferences, contributed chapters in many books, and has won many, many best paper prizes. Our next chairperson is Dr. Ranjana Sharma. Madam is a senior consultant, Apollo Hospital, Indraprastha Apollo Hospital. Madam is the chairperson of the AICC RCOG North Zone. Madam is the best obstetrician gynecologist in New Delhi, a renowned obstetrician gynecologist at Indraprastha Apollo Hospital. She had many professional membership, which includes fellow of Royal College of Obstetrician and Gynecologists of London. Madam have got many, many awards and recognitions, and we are always happy to have Madam's input in various subjects. Now I'll request Madam to introduce our first speaker of the day, Dr. Mamta Dagar. Over to you, ma'am.
Okay, so thank you very much, Mala, for the kind words. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am, we can hear you, ma'am.
So thank you very much, Mala, and the whole team for giving me this opportunity. And it's always a pleasure to be among you all and interact professionally with you people. It's really my pleasure. So and a great pleasure to introduce a colleague, Professor Mamta Dagar, who's an MD MRCOG and a very, very active member of the North Zone AICC RCOG. And she's a senior consultant and professor at GRIPMA Institute of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Gangaram Hospital. And her areas of interest, high-risk pregnancy, preventive oncology, gynae endoscopy, and robotic surgery. And her associations and affiliations, we all know how hard she's worked as secretary of AOGD. Just, you know, she's still working. And in the last 3 years, you know, we've seen her efficiency. In the last 1 year, sorry. And then she's also a treasurer, ISCCP, from 2018 to 2021. And she's a member reproductive endocrinology committee of AOGD, and then member endoscopy committee AOGD, and clinical examiner for MRCOG part 3 examinations. So great to hear, you know, I'm waiting to hear from you, Mamta, and the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks for the kind introduction. So I will start share my screen. But before I start sharing my screen, I am in fact very elated to give my presentation amidst the two stalwarts in urogynecology, Dr. Ranjana and Dr. Geeta Mediratta. And so I will start sharing my screen. Can you see?
We can see, yeah. We can see the screen.
Yeah, I will just make it full screen. You can all see my screen. I shall be basically talking about UTI in women, and to make it more informative and interesting, it will be in the form of case study and management. So basically, my presentation will outline, besides the introduction, definition, and classification of UTI and various types of UTI, uncomplicated cystitis and pyelonephritis, asymptomatic bacteria in pregnancy, complicated urinary tract infection, and what is the role of sufuroxam in exotil in UTI. We all know that almost 60% of the feminine population experience an acute episode of UTI in their lifetime. This problem is not an uncommon problem in females, and of which 25 to 50% will develop experiences with multiple episodes of UTI. But to start with the basic definition of urinary tract infection, which we all know is the presence of characteristic symptoms and significant bacteria from the kidneys to the bladder. Most of the laboratories regard 10^5 colony forming units per ml as a threshold for diagnosing significant bacteria. And the bacteria is the presence of bacteria in urine, which could be symptomatic or asymptomatic. And the presence of bacteria doesn't equate to UTI, especially in population over 65 years of the age. The UTI is a most common bacterial infection in the ambulatory care settings and also common in inpatients. And of course, it occurs more commonly in females than in males. And the reason being due to the anatomical predisposition in females, the close proximity of urethra to the anus and the short length of urethra in females. So if we come down to the basic classifications and definitions as per European Association of Urology, EAU definition, uncomplicated UTI is occurrence of acute, sporadic, or recurrent lower or upper urinary tract infection, which could be if it is involving the lower urinary tract cystitis or upper urinary tract called uncomplicated pyelonephritis. And essentially, it is limited to non-pregnant females and premenopausal females who do not have any identifiable or known anatomic or functional abnormalities within the urinary tract or other comorbidities such as immunocompromised states and diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes. While complicated UTI, as all UTI is not defined as uncomplicated, that is UTI, occurrence of UTI in patients with increased chances of complicated course, and these are like UTI in males, pregnant females, patients with relevant anatomical or functional abnormalities of urinary tract, such as presence of stones, strictures, and urinary diversions, patients with indwelling catheters and with renal diseases or concomitant in compromised states and diabetes. Further, to define recurrent UTI, recurrence of uncomplicated or complicated UTI is like when the frequency is at least three in a year or two UTI in the last 6 months. There is an entity called catheter-associated UTI, where the UTI is occurring in a person whose urinary tract is currently catheterized or has had a catheter in place within the past 48 years. While urosepsis is basically a more severe problem, which is defined as life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by a dysregulated hormone response to infection originating from the urinary tract or male genital tract. So with this background, I proceed further, coming down to the etiology and epidemiology. As per the ICMR and AMSN data 2017, as I said, nearly one in three women will have had at least one episode of cystitis by the age of 24 years. And the prevalence of UTI, whether it is asymptomatic bacteria or symptomatic UTI in pregnancy, ranges from 3 to 25% in India. As far as the prevalence of asymptomatic bacteria is concerned, it is to the tune of 5% in healthy premenopausal women, 1.9 to 95% in pregnant women, 2.8 to 8.6% in postmenopausal women, and the incidence is increased to 25 to 50% in admitted or institutionalized elderly women. So coming down to the risk factor for urinary tract infections, as I said, the females have a higher and the girls have a higher predisposition for getting UTI. There are other factors which increase the risk for UTI, which include a previous history of UTI, presence of sexual activity, especially with a newer sexual partner, changes in the vaginal flora or acidity, which is caused by menopause or use of spermicides, pregnancy, age, older age groups, reduced morbidity, mobility in conditions such as after surgery or prolonged bed rest, presence of urinary incontinence or urinary catheter placement, renal stones, prostatic enlargement, and diabetes. So these are the other risk factor for UTI. So I will begin with uncomplicated cystitis. And I will present this case to you. A 21-year-old female presented to the doctor complaining of increased frequency, dysuria, and sensation of incomplete voiding for last 2 days. She is otherwise healthy, takes no medication. She is sexually active, using condoms for contraception. There is no complaint of fever, chills, vaginal discharge, or flank pain. Sexually active with one partner, no history of sexually transmitted infection. She looks little uncomfortable, is afebrile with a normal blood pressure, and her abdominal examination is notable for mild suprapubic tenderness, no right upper quadrant pain, or no costovertebral tenderness, which is present. On the gram staining of urine, numerous gram negative rods suggestive of E. coli grew from the specimen, and urine analysis further revealed bacteria of 5+, leukocyte esterase present, WBC is 15 to 20 high power field, nitrite positive, and RBCs are present. So what is the likely diagnosis? It is acute uncomplicated cystitis. So before we basically embark onto the treatment and other treatment options, as I said, cystitis is an infection of the bladder, which is usually caused by bacteria, which is entering the bladder through the urethra and traveling up to the bladder. And E. coli is the most common causative agent in up to 95% of the cases. However, there are other agents which include Staphylococcus saprophyticus and Klebsiella pneumoniae and Proteus, which are the culprits in causation of acute uncomplicated cystitis. As far as the clinical diagnosis is concerned, as per the EAU recommendation, it is essentially clinical. You diagnose uncomplicated cystitis in women who have no other risk factors for complicated UTI based on a focused history and based on the symptoms of dysuria, frequency, and urgency, and absence of vaginal discharge or irritation. However, in postmenopausal women, in elderly, in children, the patient may present with other symptoms such as malignant nocturia, incontinence, or foul-smelling urine, where these symptoms also may be considered to clinically diagnose acute uncomplicated cystitis. As far as the lab diagnosis is concerned, it is basically this lab evaluation as per the guideline may not be necessary to diagnose in healthy ambulatory women who present with typical symptoms of UTI in the absence of vaginal discharge. And urine, but there is a role of urine analysis, urine culture, dipstick testing, which can be useful if the diagnosis is unclear. So as the EAU recommendation, the urine culture are not mandatory to diagnose and urine analysis for acute uncomplicated cystitis, but it is a must. Urine culture is a must in suspected acute pyelonephritis. Symptoms which do not resolve or recur within 4 weeks after the completion of treatment, women who present with atypical symptoms, and in pregnant females. And in patients who present with symptoms which suggest uncomplicated cystitis, need to have a colony count of 10^3 CFU per ml of uropathogens to confirm the microbiological diagnosis. Coming down to the treatment of uncomplicated cystitis, antimicrobial therapy is recommended because the clinical success is significantly more likely in women who are treated with antimicrobials as compared to placebo. There are enough trials on that. But what should be the choice of agent? It should be individualized with consideration of factors such as spectrum coverage and susceptibility patterns of etiopathogens, presence of allergies, compliance history of the patient, tolerability and adverse reactions to any antimicrobial agent, local practice patterns or guidelines, and availability of the antimicrobial agent in the community. So as per the EAU or an European Association of Urology guidelines, these are the suggestive regimes for antimicrobial therapy in uncomplicated cystitis. And the first line agent in women with uncomplicated cystitis are fosfomycin, nitrofurantoin, macrocrystal, monohydrate macrocrystals or macrocrystals prolonged release, and fivmesylenam, though it is not available with us. And the duration, as you see, for fosfomycin is 1 day, and for other it is 3 to 5 days. But when we are giving nitrofurantoin, we need to give it for 5 days. Other alternatives, if the woman is not, for some reasons, unable to take, and we are not able to give fosfomycin and nitrofurantoin, then the alternative is cephalosporin, ciprodexil 500 milligram BD for this treatment is for 3 days. But if the local resistance pattern for E. coli is less than 20%, the other alternatives which could be considered is the trimethoprim and trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination, which is available by the name of Ceptron. And the treatment duration is for 3 to 5 days. So in the treatment of uncomplicated cystitis, as per EAU guidelines, the fluoroquinolones and aminopenicillins are no longer suitable for antimicrobial therapy in uncomplicated cystitis, the reason being negative ecological effects and worldwide higher resistance rate. Aminopenicillins is a combination with beta-lactamase inhibitors such as ampicillin selbectone or amoxicillin clavulanic acid or oral cephalosporins. They are in general not effective as a short-term therapy, but definitely are not recommended for empirical therapy due to the ecological collateral damage. But there is a role of them in selected cases and situations. Coming down to the just a second, I think. Coming down to the uncomplicated pyelonephritis, as the name implies, pyelonephritis is the inflammation of the kidney, and wherein the besides renal pelvises, inflammation of the renal pelvis, renal cortex, and there may be cortical atrophy and scarring in severe cases. So we will move on to the case straightway. This is a 33-year-old diabetic woman who presents to the emergency with complaint of chills, nausea, low backache for last 2 days. And earlier in the week, she developed increased urinary frequency and dysuria, for which she recognized the symptoms of UTI and took 2 days of nitrofurantoin, but was unable to finish the treatment because of occurrence of nausea and vomiting. In the past medical history, there has been 2 episodes of UTI a few years back, which were treated with trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination, and she is on oral antibiotic medicine for type 2 diabetes with no history of STD or vaginal discharge. On physical examination, she looks unwell, uncomfortable. She has pyrexia, 101 temperature, tachycardia, mucous membranes are dry. On abdominal examination, there is suprapubic tenderness and costovertebral tenderness, which is present. And urine analysis, urine microscopic examination shows presence of WBCs of 4200 high power field, RBCs are present, and leukocyte esterase and nitrite test is positive. The urine and blood samples were sent for cultures and patient was admitted to hospital. Ultrasound suggested a relatively enlarged kidney with increased cortical echogenicity compared with the right kidney and suggests parenchymal swelling due to inflammation. The urine culture was positive for E. coli. So basically, essentially, from this case, this is a case of acute pyelonephritis. And uncomplicated pyelonephritis, if we look at the epidemiology and etiology, it is essentially the same as in cystitis, though acute pyelonephritis is less common as compared to cystitis. The annual incidence reported here was 12 to 13 per 10,000 women. And pyelonephritis is likely to recur regardless of age, gender, or treatment. And it is essentially caused by the bacteria, which are the same for cystitis, and the bacteria causing pyelonephritis are the same. As I said, E. coli is predominating in 70 to 95%, followed by other pathogens such as Klebsiella, Proteus, and Staphylococcus saprophyticus. So to diagnose uncomplicated pyelonephritis, besides this clinical consideration, which is suggested by the presence of fever of more than 38, presence of chills, flank pain, nausea, vomiting, costovertebral tenderness, with or without the typical symptoms of cystitis, what the recommendation is that UAE guidelines suggest and recommend that urine analysis, including the assessment of white and red blood cells and nitrite, is performed for routine diagnosis. Urine culture and antimicrobial susceptibility testing is to be performed in patients with pyelonephritis, and imaging of urinary tract to be performed to exclude urgent urological disorders such as stones, strictures, or urinary diversions. For uncomplicated pyelonephritis, EAU guideline recommendation is that there is definitely a role of outpatient management in a subset of patients, and the fluoroquinolones and cephalosporins are the only agents which are recommended for oral empirical therapy of uncomplicated pyelonephritis, but the local fluoroquinolone resistance should be less than 10%. There is a role of trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole or an oral beta-lactam as an alternative where there is fluoroquinolone hypersensitivity or known resistance and the uropathogens is known to be susceptible. Other agents such as nitrofurantoin, phosphomycin and pivmecillinam do not achieve adequate renal tissue levels and should be avoided, which were indicated in cases of acute cystitis. The reason being that we want to attain a good circulation of the antibiotics in the blood to treat pyelonephritis, which is not the case in cystitis. In acute cystitis, we want the antibiotic secretions to be concentration to be more in urine. So this is the rationale. And the appropriate antimicrobial should be chosen based on the local resistance patterns and optimized on the basis of drug susceptibility results if we need to treat a case of acute uncomplicated pyelonephritis, though as an outpatient basis. For the suggested regimes for oral empirical antimicrobial treatment in uncomplicated pyelonephritis, as I said, there is a role of quinolones, ciprofloxacin, levofloxacin. There is a role of trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole and cefpodoxim and ceftibuten. There is a role of fluoroquinolone, but the resistance should be less than 10%. And if such agents are used empirically, then an initial IV dose of long-acting parenteral antimicrobial, that is ceftriaxone, should be administered in cases of acute pyelonephritis. And the treatment duration, as you see with the oral, if you are considering oral antimicrobial therapy for acute uncomplicated pyelonephritis, has to be for 10 to 14 days. Then inpatient management, which is usually the management and mostly the management for acute uncomplicated pyelonephritis. As these patients frequently require hospitalization, they should be treated initially with an intravenous antimicrobial regimen, which may include fluoroquinolones, oral aminoglycosides with or without ampicillin or an extended spectrum cephalosporin or penicillin. And carbamazepine should only be considered where early culture results indicate the presence of multi-drug resistant organisms, not left or right, in every case of acute pyelonephritis to begin with. And the choice between the agents should be based on the local resistance pattern and then optimized based on the results of drug susceptibility test. Patients who improve clinically and can tolerate oral fluids, then they can be switched over to the oral therapy. So as per the guideline for uncomplicated pyelonephritis, these are the suggested empirical parenteral regimes. The first line treatment are ciprofloxacin, levofloxacin, cefotaxime, and ceftriaxone. And second line treatment is cefepime, piperacillin, tazobactam combinations, and aminoglycosides. And alternatives such as carbamazepine to be considered when there is MDR resistance, which is suspected. I will be now talking about asymptomatic bacteria in pregnancy, which is quite a common entity which we encounter in our day-to-day practice, we obstetrician. And I shall be reading this case of a pregnant female aged 30 with 7 weeks of gestation, Gravida 3, Para 2, visited to the doctor for routine antenatal visit with no other complaint, and her clinical examination was normal. They did the urine analysis and culture as per the routine antenatal screening, and the examination suggested that there is significant bacteria with E. coli of more than 10 to the power 5 CFU per ml in two consecutive samples, 24 hours apart. So the likely diagnosis is asymptomatic bacteria in pregnancy, and the treatment, I shall be just talking about that. To diagnose asymptomatic bacteria, basically, we need to have two consecutive voided urine specimen with isolation of the same bacteria strain in quantitative counts of more than or equal to 10 raised to the power 5 colony forming unit. And as the name implies, asymptomatic bacteria is the isolation of a specified quantitative account of bacteria in an appropriately collected urine sample from an individual without symptoms or signs of urinary tract infection. So the woman is essentially asymptomatic. It is common, I say 2 to 8%, but the prevalence in the population varies with age, sex, and presence of genitourinary abnormalities. And we have already talked about the occurrence of asymptomatic bacteria in different age groups earlier. So when not to treat asymptomatic bacteria is like not all the women with asymptomatic bacteria require treatment, such as premenopausal women, non-pregnant women, but the pregnant females and the postmenopausal females, they will require, and with complicating factors. Asymptomatic bacteria in pregnancy, if left untreated, it associated with adverse maternal and perinatal outcomes. We all know that essentially it leads to preterm delivery and infants low birth weight, and again E. coli is the most common organism which is being isolated from bacteriuretic women. And why these women more prone, pregnant women, again is the physiological changes in the genitourinary tract which are occurring, which make the pregnant women more susceptible to occurrence of asymptomatic bacteria. Again, point to be noted is that asymptomatic bacteria, if left untreated in pregnancy, make these women more susceptible to the occurrence of pyelonephritis. And these women with asymptomatic bacteria in early pregnancy, they have a 20 to 30 fold increased risk of developing pyelonephritis during pregnancy compared to women without bacteria. And that is the whole idea behind screening this woman in early pregnancy to diagnose and treat asymptomatic bacteria. So is treatment of asymptomatic bacteria beneficial in pregnant women? There are enough trials supporting this. Definitely we need to treat this woman. The screening for and treatment of asymptomatic bacteria in premenopausal non-pregnant women is not indicated, but in pregnant women, as compared to placebo or no treatment, the antibiotic treatment was associated with reduced number of symptomatic UTIs, resolution of bacteria, occurrence of low birth weight, and lower rates of preterm deliveries in treated group. And based on the beneficial maternal side effects of antibiotic treatment, pregnant women definitely should be screened and treated for asymptomatic bacteria. As far as the management treatment and duration is concerned, the trials compared the efficacies of single dose antibiotic treatment versus the short treatment, which was of 2 to 7 days, and which were compared in these women. And the data suggested that the single dose treatment, though, was associated with a significantly lower rate of side effects, but it was causing more babies with low birth weight. So the IDSA and EAU guidelines recommend that a standard short course of antibiotic treatment of 2 to 7 days should be used to treat asymptomatic bacteria in pregnancy. And which antibiotics to be used in pregnancy? We know that levofloxacin, Uflox, and Norflox category quinolones, they are contraindicated in pregnancy. Ciprofloxacin is to be better avoided during pregnancy. Nitrofurantoin, contraindicated in pregnant women at term from 38 to 42 weeks of gestation because of the resulting hemolysis and hyperbilirubinemia in the newborn, as well as during labor and delivery. There is an agent, ciferoxin, which is a second generation oral cephalosporin, which is a category B drug, which can be used for asymptomatic bacteria in pregnancy due to the susceptible pathogens, provided the benefit outweighs the risk, as it is a category B drug. Coming down to the second last part of my presentation, complicated urinary tract infection. As the name implies, complicated UTI occurs in an individual in whom risk factors such as underlying diabetes or immunosuppression, or there are specific anatomic or functional urinary tract abnormalities such as obstruction, incomplete voiding due to the detrusor muscle dysfunction, they are present, which can result in an infection which will be more difficult to eradicate than an uncomplicated infection. And as per EAU consensus definition of complicated UTI includes all UTI not defined as uncomplicated, that is UTI patients with an increased chance of complicated course, which include, as I said, all males, pregnant females, patients with anatomic or functional abnormalities, indwelling catheters, immunocompromised states, and diabetes. Etiology, again, here, there is a slight difference that the besides E. coli, a broad range of microorganisms cause complicated UTI. The spectrum is much larger than uncomplicated UTIs. And the bacteria here are more likely to be resistant than those isolated in uncomplicated UTIs. And these bacteria are essentially E. coli, Proteus, Klebsiella, Pseudomonas, Escherichia, and Enterococci species, which are most common species which are found in culture. Though E. coli is the most common pathogen. The laboratory urine culture is a must and recommended to determine the presence or absence of clinically significant bacteria. in patients who are suspected to have complicated UTI. As far as the management goes, in the general management, as per EAU guideline, management of any urological abnormality or underlying complicating factors is mandatory. Urine culture and susceptibility testing should be performed. Initial empirical therapy should be tailored and followed by appropriate antibiotic regimes based on the isolated pathogen. Optimal antimicrobial therapy for complicated UTI depends on severity of illness at the time of presentation, the local resistance patterns, and specific host factors such as allergies. Patients with UTI with systemic symptoms require hospitalization should be treated with intravenous antimicrobial regime. Which regime? Use a combination of amoxicillin plus an aminoglycoside, second generation cephalosporin plus an aminoglycoside, third generation cephalosporin intravenously as empirical treatment of complicated UTI with systemic symptoms. And only use ciprofloxacin provided that the local resistance percentage are less than 10% when the entire treatment you want to give orally and the patients do not require hospitalization or has an anaphylaxis for beta-lactam antimicrobial agents. At the same time, do not use ciprofloxacin or other fluoroquinolones for the empirical treatment of complicated UTI in patients from the urology department or where the patient have used fluoroquinolones in last 6 months. Coming down to the last part of the presentation, recurrent UTI in elderly women. I will just read out this case to you. 63-year-old residing in an old homage had complaint of dysuria, worsening chronic urinary frequency and incontinence and nocturia. She was a case of hyperlipidemia, hypertension, long-standing type 2 diabetes mellitus for last 25 years, for which she was on treatment with metoprolol, simvastatin, and has been on long-acting insulin. In the past history, in the same year, she had two episodes of UTI with E. coli and Klebsiella. In the past episode, she was treated with she was susceptible to penicillin and all tested cephalosporins, nitrofurantoin, and trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole combination and treated with nitrofurantoin and each episode. The examination revealed pyrexia, tachycardia, costovertebral angle tenderness. Urine examination suggested, urine analysis suggested pyuria, and dipstick revealed leukocyte esterase and nitrite presence, and urine culture more than 10 raised to the power colony forming unit for E. coli. So the likely diagnosis here as per by definition is the recurrent UTI, and to basically treat these women we need to follow this algorithm for treatment of recurrent UTI in adult women. So to begin with, a thorough history and physical examination including review of her past documented UTIs and pelvic examination. So basically, if the examination is not normal, suppose there is an elderly woman presence of atrophic vaginitis, treat with estrogen therapy. If there are other suspicious complicating factors, and definitely you need to do additional investigations, consider imaging, cystoscopy, and video urodynamics to diagnose those complicating factors, and treatment of underlying abnormalities definitely indicated. But if the examination is normal, then there is a role of, yes, in recurrent UTI, a self-start therapy. In cases of infrequent recurrences, if the patient is considered to be compliant and reliable, and there is the antimicrobial prophylaxis definitely is indicated. There is an entity called post-coital UTI wherein the woman is getting after every act of coitus. So here also you basically need to give these women antibiotic prophylaxis post-coital, but not to exceed more than one dose per 24 hours. Otherwise, continuously you need to give this woman on prophylaxis regime daily up to 6 months and then consider weaning later on. They say that there is now a role of non-antibiotic prophylaxis in cases of recurrent UTI in adult women. And the studies have suggested a role of cranberry and methenamine salts and vitamin C in the prevention of a recurrence in cases of UTI. I will just briefly talk about this drug, ciforoxime hexatil, a potential choice, why and where there is a role. This antibiotic has a better spectrum of activity as compared to cephalexin against key UTI pathogens like E. coli and Klebsiella pneumoniae. And as you see there, like these are the organisms where there is this drug is effective. And the antibiotics in UTI, the factors to consider, you know, like where it is indicated sulfuroxamine in cases of uncomplicated UTIs, indicated for use in children and with UTIs. Pregnancy, it is compared a category B drug with no known side effects and no effects on blood glucose levels as with the quinolones. Similarly, like as I said, if you compare with nitrofurantoin, then the basic advantage is that sulfuroxamine is primarily excreted by the kidneys. In patients with markedly impaired renal function, it is recommended that the dose of sulfuroxamine should be reduced to compensate for its slower excretion. But yeah, definitely there is a role where in renal impairment, you cannot consider nitrofurantoin. So is sulfuroxamine a suitable option for the management of UTI? There is no experimental evidence of embryopathy or teratogenic side effects which are attributable to this drug, but it should be administered with caution during the early months of pregnancy. It is to be used during pregnancy only if the benefit outweighs the risk, and definitely after knowing the antimicrobial spectrum. And susceptibility patterns vary with time and geography. Always refer to local susceptibility data before prescribing the drug. So with this, I come to the end of my presentation and conclude by saying that the women are more likely at risk of developing UTIs. UTI in pregnancy, maternal and fetal considerations are very important. You have to have a rational use of antibiotics, which is the key principle in managing UTI. The recurrent UTIs, there is challenging. Evidence-based approach needs to be employed, which can lead to successful clinical outcomes. And sulfuroxamine acetyl has established clinical and bacteriological efficacy in treating UTI historical clinical trials in the indicated cases. Thank you. Thank you for the patient hearing.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Mamta. Hello. Hello.
Yes, ma'am, I can hear you. I will just stop share my screen now. Yes, ma'am, right. You can hear.
Okay, so thank you, Mamta. Thank you for that wonderful elucidation of the principles, especially when you talk about pregnancy and asymptomatic bacteriuria. The drug of choice, near term, do not use nitrofurantoin. Before term, you can use it. And all the antibiotics. I would just like to add the role of the UPEX, you know, the uropathogenic E. coli, which are specifically genetically, you know, there are genetic carriers of this. Mm-hmm. So that is why you have certain women who have a very common incidence of E. coli in their lives. And they get precipitated by recurrent sexual intercourse or, you know, in menopausal age, they are the group. And second thing I wanted to point out was two concepts. One is a reinfection. And one is a persistent infection. So we have to treat them differently. Like if you had a UTI, you have not treated it perfectly. The bacteria is persistent. So that's a persistent infection.
It is like a
recurrent infection. Yeah. Yes. Another infection can be, you know, a reinfection. Maybe first is E. coli. Second was maybe Proteus or Staphylococcus or Pseudomonas in an institutionalized lady. And third thing which I wanted to point out was, as a matter of thumb rule for the PGs, you can just put your money on nitrofurantoin as the first treatment of choice for 7 days as the primary. And then you can use nitrofurantoin as a post-coital prophylaxis, as you very rightly said, you know, the lady herself takes 100 milligram dose within 3 hours of intercourse. So that is one. Another rule of thumb is to use septum in pregnancy, especially near term, avoid using nitrofurantoin. And what was the other thing I was thinking? Yeah, the role of having, like, a PGs should know when you see a urine routine examination and you find leukocyte esterase positive, nitrites positive, how do you interpret? Now I want to tell them that if these are, supposing you have nitrite and all, then kindly do not add an alkalinizer to the nitrofurantoin, because how nitrofurantoin acts is it acts in an acidic medium. You are, alkalinizing it, on one hand, how do you expect NIFRAN to act? So it's a very important practical point that urinary alkalinizers should not be given in women who need the antibiotic to act in an acidic urine. It's a practical point, just I wanted to clarify.
Yeah, very right.
And of course, D-mannose is another thing which they said it coats the bladder, doesn't let the UPEX cling on to the thing. But these are all non-antibiotic methods of treating UTI. So these are the few comments I had. Anyway, you've covered beautifully. I must congratulate you.
Dr. Geeta, I find that's a very useful tip that you give. Before prescribing an alkalinizer, which is just given left, right, and center without any blockage. So,
Dr. Ranjana, ma'am, wants to, I think, give her input. Dr. Ranjana.
Now, I said if there is time, can I add something?
Yes,
Dr. Ranjana.
Okay. Okay, so something very, very basic, you see. See, when we all UTI patients come to us and say, I have a UTI.
Without unmuting.
Sorry? Can't you hear me?
Yes, you can. Ma'am, we can hear you.
Doctor? Yeah. So, one thing, you know, patients come to us and they'll sit in front of us and say, I have got a UTI. Or I had two UTIs in the past. So actually all UTIs, when they say, are not actually UTIs, one thing. So we need to check how many times they actually had UTIs. And now we also know about this bladder pain syndrome or interstitial cystitis, that they minimum 7 years, you know, before they are diagnosed to have something different. And they move from one doctor to another and have one course of antibiotic and then another course, and they keep everyone trying one antibiotic or the other, and they don't even have a UTI.
Yeah.
One thing is this. Secondly, you know, just simple routine microscopy examination of the urine. Just want to comment on that. So if you see, people think, you know, they have to have a culture to establish an infection. But if you do a proper urine routine and microscopic examination, it is going to tell you more than what culture can. So it should be the first urine sample of the day, and culture can be done any time of the day, because culture, you know, you are going to multiply the organisms, that's okay. But the for urine routine microscopy, try to do as in the first sample. Now what you want to see, you see what nitrites mean, what leukocyte esterase mean to everybody, right? So what they mean, like, all organisms will not convert nitrate to nitrite. Okay, so lots of times we don't nitrite negative. So nitrite is a very, very specific test for infection, but not a very sensitive test. So, you know, if you haven't taken enough nitrates in your diet, if you have, you know, have used diuretics, so diuresis, it has gone. And some bacteria do not change nitrate into nitrite. So like Acinobacter and stuff like that. So enterococci, they will not. And some will convert quickly from nitrate, not to nitrite, and then nitrogen. They'll quick convert nitrate to nitrogen. So then also you have negative nitrite. So leukocyte esterase is more sensitive that way. You see, leukocyte means white cell, right? WBCs. So that means, you know, WBCs, if leukocyte esterase negative, that means WBCs are not there and infection is less likely. But again, negative test will not exclude negative nitrite or negative leukocyte esterase, but it tells you a lot if it is positive. Okay. And so first sample, that's what I want to say. And lots of time patients have symptoms just because, see, hardly any, you know, resident sees the pH. If the pH is so low, the patient will be really miserable with symptoms. So if you just change the pH to alkaline, patient's symptoms go away. Right? It may not be an infection, but pH 5. And patient feels, you know, symptom UTI-like symptoms. So if you give them something like alkalizer, yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah, that is why it is very important for us to consider the differential diagnosis in our mind, vaginitis, urethritis, as well as in elderly, you know, it really has to be the UTI, the diagnosis really has to be very judiciously made after bringing out those painful bladder syndromes and all, you know, yeah. Those could, yeah, really are troublesome for a long time.
Thank you very much. Very nice presentation, Mamta. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Jinnah, and I always second you that it is the, you know, the beauty lies in the details. As I said, you have to see the routine, microscopic, all the 5-6 points, whether there are casts, whether they are crystals, you know, what is the specific gravity, what is the pH. So all these things are important in making, you know, what the PGs, they just see, you know, the PGs, what they see, they will just see, you know, pus cells present. Now, if she has got a bad vaginitis, bad discharge, then maybe the pus, the source of the pus is that. So they have to be very careful that tell the patient that it should be preferably a morning urine. Just clean with plain water and put a midstream sample if they can. Otherwise, it doesn't matter. They can put the even first void as long as their vulva is clean. And second thing, Mamta, I just wanted to bring out, whenever you have candida or any fungal, think of cox or an immunosuppressed or an HIV positive patient. You know, sometimes you do have a urine culture with this candida, etc. So that commensal is, especially you keep your mind open for cox and HIV.
Very right, ma'am.
Just few practical points. I think Dr. Ranjana and myself, we just want to bring, of course, the theoretical part you have gained, but the basic things to grasp by the PGs is this, that basic, how do you, antibiotic, anybody will know. Ceftum in pregnancy, nitrofurantoin, otherwise complicated ones, fluoroquinolones. That's a rule of thumb. Right. Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. So, to basically for the next talk, I take this opportunity to call the chairpersons of the session. Doctor, may I have the CVs projected, please? Doctor Debashish Dutta, sir, is the senior consultant, senior gynae endoscopic and robotic surgeon at Sir Gangaram Hospital. And as you see his CV, he has an immense experience of 31 years in the field of gynecology and besides in Gangaram, earlier also at other institutes, he's practiced. And his specialty besides obstetrics and gynecology is laparoscopic surgery. Our second chairperson is Dr. Tripti Sharan. I welcome you, sir. Dr. Tripti Sharan, she is a senior consultant in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at B.L. Kapoor Super Speciality Hospital, Delhi. And her areas of interest are high-risk pregnancy, critical care in obstetrics, reproductive endocrinology, minimal invasive surgery. And besides that, I know that she's a very good writer. And as you see, she has so many laurels to her credit. And she has her unique way of presenting things. I have seen her books, and these are the several the books she has authored, The Chronicles of a Gynecologist, House of Doctors, and Being Radha, and award-winning poetry books. She's also a columnist with NDTV, Every Life Counts, The Better India, and an active blogger. So I invite you and I welcome you, Dr. Tripti, to this session. And over to you now, over to the chairpersons to introduce the speaker.
Thank you, Mamta, for the lovely description. You've been very, very generous, actually. So Dr. Debashish, yeah. Are you going to introduce your own Kanika?
That would be a little... quintessential. I would let Dr. Tripp do the job. I know Konika so well, so I'll probably add too many accolades rather than this thing. So Dr. Tripp, please take the honors.
Well, I don't want to compete with you who knows her better, but well, I have the privilege, so I'll introduce her. So our speaker for today is Dr. Kanika Jain, who's a senior consultant, and she's also the vice president AOGD. And she has a lot of fellowships in endoscopy surgery, gynae robotic surgery, and we all know that she's a very accomplished endoscopic as well as a robotic surgeon. She's a life member of AOGD, FOXI, NARCHI, IFS, and ISOSORP, and had her training from robotic hands-on at Pune, as well as from Paris, France. So now I find that very, very impressive. And yes, of course, it goes without saying that this is her field of interest, which is gynae endoscopy and gynae oncology. Over to you, Dr. Kanika, to start today's session.
Thank you, Tripti. And actually, I have a good choice between a dear friend and my senior, my boss, Dr. Datta. So let's start.
Don't call me a boss. I mean, we're just colleagues. And I'm lucky to have her as my colleague, really speaking. Okay. Yeah, Kanika, over to you. So, screen is all yours.
Sir, can you see my screen share?
Yeah, I can. I can.
Okay. So I would be today talking on the nuances of antibiotics in the gynecological surgery. So basically, it is actually becoming a nuance. The antibiotics are just being given left, right, and center, which is leading on to resistance with the antibiotics and less of beneficial and more of harmful effects that the antibiotics are giving us. So as an overview, we see that surgical antibiotic prophylaxis is, like, I am going to just talk about it, and I'll be talking about the wound healing and the factors associated, then the guidelines, whatever we have, the overall picture, and the recommendations for surgical site infection prophylaxis in common gynae practice, in laparoscopic procedures, and in special conditions. Then the recent advances regarding cephalosporins, and then the conclusion. So to start with the surgical prophylaxis introduction, SSIs, or the surgical site infections, are a major cause of morbidity and mortality. We all know less of mortality, but it's definitely morbidity. And the surgical patients, they have increasingly more complex comorbidities. And there is being an emergence of antimicrobial resistant pathogens. And we're facing this problem with each kind of infection. And especially, as we all know, that the with the TB, definitely multidrug resistant tuberculosis is posing a problem, a threat to the world. So this happens with all the antibiotics, and it is a threat to the world because it's an ever-increasing challenge. And it increases the cost and the challenge of treating the infections. So SSIs, they represent 15% of all nosocomial infections, and these are associated with prolonged hospitalization time and increased antibiotic use. The wide range of factors need to be addressed by the physicians when aiming to prevent SSI. So as in this case, as always, prevention is better than cure, and prevention has to be addressed properly. Otherwise, the infection would definitely be there and there would be resistance to the antibiotics. So the morbidity is definitely prolonged. So a rational use of antibiotics plays an important role in the SSI prophylaxis. So what are the definitions? According to the WHO, the Global Guidelines for Prevention of SSIs, what exactly is surgical site infection? They say a post-surgical site infection at the incision site. Basically, surgical infections that involve the skin only. And more serious SSIs are if they involve the subcutaneous tissue. And more serious if they involve a particular organ or the implanted material. And any infection which occurs within 30 days of the postoperative period, which involves the skin, subcutaneous tissue, and or deeper structures, is called an SSI. And maybe not applicable to the gynae field, but any implant if left inside, and then if the infection occurs within a year, that also qualifies into surgical site infection. Then what are the standard antibiotic prophylaxis? What do we mean by that? There is prevention of the infectious complications by administering an effective antimicrobial agent prior to surgery. Now each word counts. It should be effective. It should be, the dose should be adequate. And the timing prior to surgery is very important. So it should be correct timing, correct dose, and not excess and not less. Then the surgical procedure, an operation where at least one incision is made through the skin or the mucous membrane, or reoperation via an incision. Just a second. Just a second. audible? Hello?
Yes, yes, Kanika, you're audible.
I'm so sorry about that. So basically an operation where at least one incision is made through the skin or the mucous membrane, or a reoperation via an incision that was left open during the surgery done prior and takes place in the operating room. That is what we what qualifies as a surgical procedure. Now the surgical wound definitions. Surgical wound is created when an incision is made and then closed in the operating room by a suture or a staple or an adhesive tape or glue. They can be subdivided into four kinds: clean, clean contaminated, contaminated, dirty, or infected. So according to the surgical wound classifications, the clean wound is where the incision is made, there is no inflammation encountered, there is no breach in the sterile technique, and it is not entering into the respiratory tract or the alimentary tract or the genitourinary tracts. Clean contaminated is one in which the incision is made through the respiratory tract or the alimentary tract or the genitourinary tract, but it is entered under under controlled conditions and no contamination is encountered. Contaminated wound is when the incision, where there is a major break in the sterile technique or gross spillage of the from the GI tract, or an incision in acute acute non-purulent inflammation is encountered, and traumatic wounds with more than 12 to 24 hours of being left behind, old wounds. So these are considered contaminated wounds. Dirty or infected, we say when the incision during an operation in which the viscera are perforated or acute inflammation with pus. And for traumatic wounds where treatment is delayed, there is fecal contamination or devitalized tissue is present. The patient risk factors for surgical site infection are perioperative hyperglycemia. Any diabetic patients with uncontrolled sugars and sugar especially more than 200 milligrams per deciliter, 180 to 200 per deciliter. So that increases the risk of having surgical site infections later on. Smoking predisposes to surgical site infections. Obesity with a BMI of more than equal to 30. The poor nutritional status of the patient. When the depth of the subcutaneous tissue is more than equal to 3 centimeters, that is again, maybe over the panniculus area or in obese patients, when we cut in that region. So the chances of infection are more. Then if there's a coexistent infection at a remote body site, like for example, a UTI or a skin infection, any such sorts, then these should be treated first prior to giving any incision anywhere else. Then vaginal colonization with microorganisms, like for example, group B streptococcal infection is very common in the vagina, or a bacterial vaginosis. These should be treated prior to starting any surgery, because especially with surgeries like hysterectomy, vaginal, abdominal, or laparoscopic, any, the vault would be opened. So in case the vagina is colonized with these bacteria, the chances of vault infection and dehiscence increases. Then the American Society of Anesthesiologists, physical status definition, according to their definition. Then immunodeficiency, any chronic steroid use, chemotherapy, etc., if the patient is on, that leads to an increased risk for infection. And the methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus infection. Then there was a study done between 2005 to 2011, studying the SSI rates in 6 cities of India. And 10 hospitals were studied in 6 cities of India. And they found that the surgical site infection rates were higher than those which were actually reported by the CDC NHSN. But they were similar to what was reported in the International Nosocomial Infection Control Consortium. So what exactly is surgical antimicrobial prophylaxis? Pathak et al. Conducted a cohort study between September 2010 to February 2013 in a tertiary care hospital in Madhya Pradesh. And 1,173 patients underwent gynecological surgeries during the study period, and the incidence of SSI in the cohort was 7.84%. And majority of the surgical site infections were superficial. Obstetrical surgeries had a lower infection rate, and the risk factors for SSI identified in the multivariate logistic regression model were the each increase in the hour of surgery after the first hour doubled the risk of SSI. And inappropriate antibiotic prophylaxis increased the risk by nearly 5 times. Each day increase in stay in the hospital after surgery increased the risk of contracting an SSI by 5%. So we adhere to the guidelines in India. Recent update by ICMR showed that up to 30% of all surgical prophylaxis is inappropriate. Whatever prophylaxis is being given in the hospitals, up to 30% of them are inappropriate. Jaggi and et al. Conducted a surgical antimicrobial prophylaxis audit, studied at a tertiary hospital in North India using hospital-based stewardship committee issued guideline. The three parameters tested for adherence showed individual compliance of 87.3% for appropriate selection of antibiotics, 85.3% for appropriate administration, and 34.9% for appropriate duration of antibiotics. So the overall adherence to pre-surgical antibiotic prophylaxis guidelines by the surgeons showed significant results. So what does SSI impact? It's basically, if we study the impact, the economic burden and the quality of life, we see that the economic burden, the financial burden is increased due to the direct cost incurred by prolonged hospitalization of the patient, the diagnostic tests and the treatment involved. Some patients may also require reoperation after contraction of an SSI associated with considerable additional costs. The quality of life, there was increased patient morbidity, mortality, and loss of earnings during the recovery. These are some of the indirect costs also associated with SSI. If the patient is hospitalized or not able to join back works, so the loss of earnings that way is also important. Indirect costs are added. Then intangible costs may also be incurred by the patient, such as pain and anxiety. Prolonged hospitalization, absence from work, and increased morbidity due to SSI has been shown to negatively impact on the patient health-related quality of life. Now, what are the commonly associated isolated pathogens in SSI? The causative bacteria in SSI vary between different sites of surgery, different hospitals, and geographic locations. So, during cesarean section, the infection rate is 4 to 15%. Normal vaginal flora like staphylococcus, streptococcus, enterococci, lactobacillus, diphtheroids, E. coli, anaerobic streptococci. These are the ones, fusibacterium, which are commonly seen to cause SSIs. And during hysterectomy, vaginal hysterectomy, we have frequently polymicrobial with enterococci, aerobic gram-negative bacilli, and bacteroids species isolated most frequently. In abdominal and radical hysterectomy, it is polymicrobial again, gram-positive cocci and enteric gram-negative bacilli and anaerobes. And 66% they said were caused by gram-negative bacilli like E. coli, Klebsiella, and Pseudomonas, probably because of close vicinity to the anal region of the vault. So SSI prophylaxis and antimicrobial resistance. Antimicrobial resistance is an increasingly serious threat to the global public health that requires action across all government sectors and society. The misuse and overuse of antimicrobials is accelerating this process as per WHO in 2018. And the development of resistance can be discouraged by appropriate use of antibiotics, not excessive, not under. So what are the guidelines? WHO evidence-based recommendations from the prevention of SSI shows preoperative measures can we take. First and foremost, a preoperative bathing. That's very important. We need not specify with soap to bathe with, how the patient should bathe, but there should be a bath before surgery, preferably the morning before surgery, and if not, at least a night before surgery. The patient should take a proper bath. There have been studies showing the soap used, it can be chlorhexidine based, it can be a normal soap, but whatever it is, a normal soap works equally effectively, but it should be a bath. Decolonization with mupirocin ointment, with or without chlorhexidine gluconate body wash, for the prevention of Staphylococcus aureus has been shown to be good, especially in nasal carriers. Screening for ESBL colonization and the impact on surgical antibiotic prophylaxis should be done if possible. Then there should be an optimal timing for preoperative surgical antibiotic prophylaxis. Like it would be mentioned in the next slides. Basically, the timing is very important. Certain like first generation cephalosporins, they say they should be given within an hour of giving the incision. And if we are giving not first generation or maybe second generation or maybe aminoglycosides, then within 2 hours can also work effectively. And like in cesarean sections, we, as soon as we clamp the cord, we should give the antibiotic prophylaxis to the mother. Then mechanical bowel preparation and the use of oral antibiotics in that also helps. In case of inadvertent opening of the bowel, the soilage of the field would be less and the associated infection would be less. Then they say that the hair removal prior to surgery should be avoided. Like the normal technique is we just write part preparation. That should be avoided as far as possible. Especially the razors should be banned. They should not be used. If at all, if the hair are actually coming into the field and obstructing, or maybe the stitching would be difficult, then the hair can be just clipped, maybe with a clipper, but a razor should not be used. And if at all it needs to be done, then it has to be done immediately before surgery, is not 2 days or 3 days prior to surgery, because that leaves the time to for the area to get colonized and infected. So the surgical site preparation, again, as I said, hair removal should be avoided, and a good bath, and then maybe the scrubbing in the OT should be preferably, they say, alcohol-based. If the patient is allergic to alcohol, then povidone iodine and mixture with 4% chlorhexidine and soap mixture can be used. Especially for the vaginal surgeries where alcohol cannot be used inside the mucous membranes, we can use povidone iodine-based mixtures or 4% chlorhexidine with soap solution. The antimicrobial skin sealants can also be used, and then definitely the scrubbing should be proper by the surgeon. So these are all the preoperative measures. Then preoperative and or intraoperative measures. We have to have a good enhanced nutritional support for the patient. Perioperative discontinuation of any immunosuppressive agents, because that may lead to definitely a lowered immunity, lowered healing power, and higher sugar perioperatively. So they should be stopped. Perioperative good oxygenation also, they say, works good. Maintaining a normal temperature or normothermia, euthermia is also very important. Any infection anywhere should be treated first prior to subjecting the patient to any surgical procedure. The use of protocols for intensive perioperative blood sugar control should be followed. There should be maintenance of adequate circulating volume control or normovolemia, because any hypovolemia or hemoconcentration can also affect the healing and can predispose to other complications as well. Then the drapes and the gowns should be sterile, and the wound protective devices should be used wherever possible. Then the post-operative measures, surgical antibiotic prophylaxis, it should not be prolonged more than required, but at the same time, adequate doses should be given. Advanced dressings are available, which should be used wherever required and possible. Antibiotic prophylaxis in the presence of a drain
then we have to be very careful. There should be an optimal timing for removal of the drain, and the drain site wound should be properly dressed. So in the antibiotic prophylaxis, what do the guidelines recommend? There are various guidelines like the American Society of Health System Pharmacists, the Infectious Disease Society of America, the Surgical Infection Society, the Society for Healthcare Epidemiology of America, the WHO guidelines, ACOG practice bulletin guidelines. So let's see. Now the ACOG recommendations in 2018, they say that perform the preoperative surgical site skin infection preparation with an alcohol-based agent, unless contraindicated. Then we can use a chlorhexidine alcohol. The preference is chlorhexidine alcohol. And in case contraindicated, then we can use 4% chlorhexidine with a soap solution mixture. For the skin antiseptics, povidone iodine scrubs for abdominal preparation and scrubbing for 5 minutes. Then again, scrubbing does not mean actually rubbing too much. The povidone iodine should be gently scrubbed, and then the solution should be left till it dries up so that even the spores are killed, and that gives a proper sterile area for skin incision. Then the vaginal cleansing with 4% chlorhexidine gluconate or povidone iodine solution can be done. 4% chlorhexidine gluconate soap containing 4% alcohol is an alternative to iodine-based preparations in case of allergy when preferred by the surgeon. And the antimicrobial prophylaxis should be initiated within an hour before the procedure begins. In obese patients, we should use weight-based dosage according to each drug dosage recommended. If the procedure is getting lengthy, additional intraoperative doses of an antibiotic can be given at intervals of 2 times the half-life of the drug, measured from the initiation of the preoperative dose. If there's excessive blood loss, especially if more than 1.5 liters, a second dose of prophylactic antibiotics should be given to prevent infection. Now, is preoperative screening for bacterial vaginosis essential before vaginal hysterectomy or any hysterectomy the procedure where we are opening the vault? There have been an increase in the vaginal concentration of microorganisms such as Gardnerella vaginalis, anaerobic microorganisms, and the genital mycoplasmas. So these are the potential pathogens. A perioperative screening for bacterial vaginosis with treatment, if present, with metronidazole or one of the other CDC recommended treatment regimes should be considered. If the therapy duration of 5 to 7 encroaches on the scheduled time for surgery, then what we can do is we have to continue the surgery postoperatively as well for at least 4 days. Now, these are antibiotic prophylactic regimes as recommended by ACOG in 2018, according to the procedure involved. They say in cases of hysterectomy, vaginal, abdominal, laparoscopic, robotic, whatever be the route, a plain and simple first generation cephalosporin like cefazolin or cefixin is good enough. It should be given in a single dose within 1 hour before the procedure. So 2 gram, or if the patient is obese, then 3 gram IV is good enough, is what they say. In uterine evacuation by DNC or suction evacuation, we need to give them antibiotics. And in such cases, doxycycline given 200 milligram for 5 days is good enough. In cases of colporephy, first generation cephalosporin again is enough. In cases of laparotomy, without entering into the bowel or the vagina, again, a first generation cephalosporin is enough. Vaginal sling placements, first generation. Cervical tissue excision procedures like LEAP, biopsy, endocervical curettage, we don't need antibiotics. In cystoscopy, we do not recommend antibiotics. In endometrial biopsy, not recommended. In laparoscopic procedures, where we are not touching the bowel and vagina is not being opened, not recommended. In HSGs, not recommended. Although I would beg to differ in this a little bit, because in HSGs, the patient are coming as an outpatient, it's an outpatient procedure, and she may be having some infection. And if we push in the dye without giving any antibiotic prophylaxis, I feel that we can introduce infection inside the pelvic cavity. So this, although the guideline says, but I beg to differ in this. And hysteroscopy, they say not recommended. IUD insertion, no antibiotic recommended. Oocyte retrieval, no antibiotic recommended. DNC, non-pregnant indication, not indicated. Urodynamic studies, not indicated. Now, patients with immediate hypersensitivity reactions to penicillin. Then in those cases, we can switch to clindamycin or metronidazole for a good anaerobic cover and gram-negative, plus gentamicin and estrionam. So this combination can be given. Recommended antibiotic prophylaxis regime for by procedure according to ACOG. Antibiotic prophylaxis is recommended for patients undergoing HSG if they have a history of PID or if their fallopian tubes are noted to be abnormal at the time of the procedure. So they are recommending if we find that the tubes are abnormal, then we give her the antibiotic, not prior to the procedure. Patients undergoing vaginal, abdominal, laparoscopic or robotic hysterectomy, including a supracervical hysterectomy, should receive a single dose antimicrobial prophylaxis. Women undergoing uterine evacuation for induced abortion, routine antibiotic prophylaxis is not recommended for the IUD insertion. In cases of vaginal delivery, they say the common pathogens encountered are the group B streptococci, which are harboring into the vagina. And they say that in women who do not know their GBS status, then in the following situations only, we should administer antibiotics like preterm labor less than 37 weeks, prolonged rupture of membranes more than 18 hours, fever during labor or chorioamnionitis, history of a previous baby with GBS infection, bladder or kidney infection due to GBS. And the preferred antibiotic is ampicillin. Alternative is then cefixin, or if allergic, then vancomycin. So they say it is not routinely recommended for a normal vaginal delivery because they're taking delivery as a kind of an abscess and or a pus. They are taking the simile with that as the fetus at the placenta is being expelled out, which is the site of or the nidus of infection. So we are, since we are just expelling it out, we do not need to give any antibiotic to the patient. In cases of third or fourth degree perineal tears, they say that common organisms are gram-positive staph aureus, gram-negative enterobacteria species, and anaerobes. So cefixitin or cefotitan, that is a second generation cephalosporin, or first generation with metronidazole, or second generation plus metronidazole, or amoxiclav mixture, and if allergic, then clindamycin. So prophylaxis is considered to prevent adverse outcomes arising from infections like fistulas. Basically, it is the vicinity of the anal region because of which we have to give them prophylaxis. Now, PROM and cesarean delivery. Preterm premature rupture of membranes. The pathogens are gram-positive GBS, gram-negative may enteric gram-negative bacilli, ureaplasma, mycoplasma, anaerobes. So the preferred antimicrobial agent is ampicillin, followed by oral MP or amox, plus oral erythro. And cesarean delivery, they say the preferred one is the first generation cephalosporin plus erythromycin. And if there's allergic, the patient is allergic, then clinda and genta combination. In cases of P. sepsis, septal abortion, chorioamnionitis, common pathogens are usually gram-positive, maybe we have streptococcus and staph aureus, gram-negative E. coli, enterobacteria, including Klebsiella, Enterobacter, Citrobacter, Pseudomonas, Proteus, Gardnerella, Bacteroides, Clostridium, and anaerobes. So the preferred antibiotics is piperacillin-tazobactam combination. Or as an alternative, we can use clindamycin-genta. If the patient is in septic shock, then imipenem, meropenem, any of the imipenems, ertapenem, and with or without vancomycin, amikacin. In cases of hysterectomy, like abdominal hysterectomy, vaginal hysterectomy, or laparoscopic, surgery for pelvic prolapse, so or a surgery for stress urinary incontinence. The common pathogens they say are Staphylococcus, Enterococcus, and aerobic gram-negative or anaerobes. So the preferred antibiotic is, if it's a clean surgery, first-generation cephalosporins, or if required, a second generation with metronidazole. In abdominal hysterectomy and laparoscopic hysterectomy, the vagina is open at the end of the procedure, and exposure to the vaginal flora is very brief. In vaginal hysterectomy, there is greater colonization of the surgical site. In abdominal hysterectomy for cancer and resection of the upper vagina, there may be colonization with anaerobes, and in such cases, metronidazole may be added. Then they say metronidazole, if given, it should be given for 7 days, beginning at least 4 days preoperatively. In laparoscopy, in cases where the uterus or the vagina are not entered, or a hysteroscopy or an ectopic pregnancy, then the common skin commensals are seen, for which cephalosporins are good enough. In cases of abortions, we need to cover for chlamydia and nisuria. So azithromycin plus metronidazole or doxycycline plus metronidazole, they should be given for 5 to 10 days. And no prophylaxis, they say, are needed for missed or incomplete abortion. In HSG, common pathogens are chlamydia, nisuria, against which we have to guard ourselves. So the preferred antibiotic is doxycycline, continued for BD dosage for 5 days. And if there is a history of PID, all the fallopian tubes are dilated at the procedure. Cefuroxime, which is the second generation cephalosporin, gives an adequate spectrum coverage against SSIs called by methicillin susceptible staph aureus, coagulase negative staph, and E. coli. It has a proven efficacy in preventing surgical site infections in cardiac, obstetric, and gynecological surgeries. It's recommended by Salisbury NHS for obstetric surgeries. A single dose of cefuroxime, 750 mg IV, immediately after the umbilical cord is clamped, significantly reduce the incidence of febrile morbidity as compared to the control group as per their study. There was no experimental evidence of embryopathy or teratogenic effects attributable to cefuroxime, but as with all drugs, it should be administered with caution during the early months of pregnancy. Now, the recent evidences regarding the surgical prophylaxis, they say it was a 1-year prospective cohort study which was done in Finland, and they saw that as the duration of the surgery increased, the incidence, the probability of infection goes up. And they say after each hour, the rate of infection increase goes up by 5%. So to conclude, SSIs are a major cause of post-surgical morbidity and mortality. Assessing and managing the risk factors for SSI is paramount. Inappropriate antimicrobial prophylaxis is also one of the risk factors for SSI. Many guidelines recommend first and second generation cephalosporins like first generation cefazolin or cefixime, and second generations like cefuroxime for the surgical antimicrobial prophylaxis in gynecological procedures. Single dose within an hour of starting procedures is good enough in most patients and procedures. Perioperative screening for bacterial vaginosis should be considered. Thank you.
Now, that was a very, very exhaustive presentation, yeah, Dr. Kanika. Dr. Devashish, you wanted to say something?
You have to actually keep it short because, you know, there's a background noise. I can't really stop because there's construction work going on in the next flat. It was wonderful. I mean, Kanika, you have covered all the angles. It was very, very insightful session. And I'm very happy to say that you have covered each and every little nitty-gritty about the antibiotic or overuse of it. And frankly saying, you know, use of prophylactic antibiotics in today's scenario, in tertiary care, teaching hospitals, I really find very little, I wouldn't say it's controversial, but I think it's a very debatable issue. You know, we don't really need to use prophylactic antibiotics if we follow the guidelines properly. And that is, you know, in clean surgery, the first group of surgery you had in the cohort of year four, this thing, as far as elective surgery and the clean surgeries are concerned. The rest group, of course, you have covered everything. So it is very nice. It was, it was a very educative talk. Dr. Trishti, please.
Yeah, actually, I wanted to put in a few points. One, that yes, prophylactic surgery is needed in our, because we come under the clean contaminated category of surgery. And at BLK, over the past 10 years, I've been the part of the audit committee, you know, trying to stop the inappropriate use of antibiotics. And we had a lot of doctors coming from the AMPI, Genta, Metrogel group, just to enforce that you have to use one antibiotic, that too cefazolin, was a big task. We gradually had 100% only one dose cefazolin, but unfortunately cefazolin is no longer available. I really don't know why. It was a beautiful drug, very cheap and inexpensive drug. And so now, because this cefazolin is not there, we are using the second generation cephalosporin, and that is SuperCef, and we've not had any wound infection. If you, so many other causes of wound infection other than antibiotic use. So we have been really happy with that. And I would say that after normal delivery, after DNC, we have not been using any antibiotic. We've had residents, doctors who have delivered with us, and they've gone home and used them on their own, saying that what kind of doctors you are. So it's a very difficult habit to shrug away. Yeah. One of my residents who later joined as SR, she said, ki mujhe nahi samajh mein, aapne mujhe antibiotic kyun nahi diya. She went and took it on her own.
Yeah, that is so, what we also see. And people are not satisfied. They feel that the discharge, if you're not writing antibiotics, then there is something lacking. SuperCef, I mean, the IV works very good.
And yes, it, and now we are trying to, you know, even wean off from oral tablets, even in cesareans. It's a really difficult for us, because we've all been trained on triple antibiotics. Metrogel is so dear to us, though all studies say that despite being gram negative and anaerobic, you don't need any prophylaxis against them. You only need a prophylaxis against the gram positive. And that too, just before the, within 30 minutes of surgery, which is again practically sometimes very difficult. We've had to train at every level, from the labor wards or pre-op ward to the recovery to the anesthetist. And sometimes we do face problems there when it is given just immediately before the incision, which is again not the right thing, because you need the peak concentration of antibiotics when you're giving the incision.
Yeah.
So these are practical problems.
Another point I just wanted to add, we should do a sensitivity test also. So that should be done at least 1.5 hours prior to the
prophylaxis. Definitely.
So that on table, the patient,
without
anesthesia, we can assess.
In our pre-op orders, Kanika, we write only test dose, you know, capital letters. Now, most of our wards as nurses are used to that. Earlier, they used to give the full dose. Another thing, if your patient is on some antibiotic of PPRM, whatever, then also you have to give a 30 minutes injectable. It is not that the perioperative period is being covered, so you need not give any antibiotic. Third, there are so many people who are very senior, very experienced people, also so fond of MonoCef. It's a habit which is very difficult to break away. That pre-op MonoCef, it gives you a false sense of security. So these have been our teething troubles. I don't know how much it might have been for yours also.
PPROM also, the moment the patient ruptures the membranes, or the moment they do an artificial rupture of membrane,
they will give an antibiotic. Even we used to do as residents, even our senior residents who come, they will not even inform you and they'll give an antibiotic the moment they do an ARM. So you have to actually teach them this. But it's been really, it gives you a very good feel when you have not used antibiotics and you don't have any
infection. And the patient goes home.
Huh? Yes.
Can I also add something here?
Yeah, Dr. Ranjana, yes.
Yeah. So the thing is, you see, I came back from the UK, you know, I was 15 years abroad. And then when I came back in 97, I also worked in small places. Right. But I have never used more than one antibiotic right from 1998. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah, we can hear you, ma'am. We can see you.
Yeah, yeah. So I have turned my video off because, you know, I think my internet is a bit dodgy.
Okay.
Right. So, and another thing, you see, not shaving. I haven't shaved people.
Yes, very right.
For how many years? You know, and I have never come across a problem with hair. So, you know, even if hair is there, you see, you can do your cesarean, you can do your hysterectomies and vaginal. Never. And I don't catheterize. And I have recently a few years, you know, I have started catheterizing because residents don't make sure that they empty their bladder after delivery or surgery. So then I was scared. Being a urogynecologist also, I was, you know, worried about the bladder health. So that's why I have started catheterizing. But I take the catheter out quickly, you know, 6 hours, right? Post-operative orders. So all these will really not then reduce your requirement for antibiotics. And then I gave thesis to my DNB candidate on prophylactic single dose antibiotics. So we did that study also. So there was, you know, no difference, but it is always better, you know. But as Tripti says, lots of patients said there was no antibiotic given.
Yes.
I had a teaching session, you know, with them. You know, I would go
through
the whole thing to make them, you know, understand that they did have antibiotic. Thank you.
Yeah. And you know, initially, and I would, I just want to add for the catheter, earlier when we started with single dose, most of the, you know, the what people used to say that the Foley's catheter is there. Hello, the I'm sorry, I'm just putting off the video because I've started for some place. So so now if the catheter is there, if the drain is there, you can't take out the, you cannot stop antibiotic, which is not actually right. So these do not mean that you have to continue on the antibiotic. And so now I would say it takes a lot of time, but it's worth putting in that much effort for, you know, preventing unnecessary and inappropriate antibiotic use. And it's a very, very good topic that Kanika, you people have chosen today. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good, Kanika. Wonderful talk. I mean, we have reiterated our stand that overuse of antibiotics is definitely not something we want. And everyone has put their strong points. Antibiotics are actually, they result from more of a fear psychosis and a kind of training we have actually gone through. So antibiotics are no to antibiotics is the message whom I would take. Thank you very much, Kanika.
Are there any questions still or any comments
Dr. Kritika raised her hand. Please let us know if we can allow to talk to her. Dr. Kritika, does she have any questions? Q&A is empty, Mamta.
Dr.
Kritika wants to.
Is she there? Talk. She can be allowed to talk.
Yeah. So I don't know.
Yeah, Mr. Vinod, can you allow Kritika to talk? Can you unmute her?
Okay, ma'am. Muted her, ma'am, but she's not speaking, I think.
Okay. So, I don't know what the question she wanted to ask something. So, if there are no questions, then I think we can call it a day. And with this, I thank all the esteemed chairpersons of the day, Dr. Debashish, Dr. Ranjana, Dr. Geeta, and Dr. Sriti. For
taking out their valuable time and giving the valuable inputs, Dr. Ranjana ma'am, for today's session. And it sounded a bit theoretical, both the topics, but I think had important take-home messages. We are extremely thankful to GSK for providing us the deck for today's presentation, and also team at the back end for the support, Mr. Vinod and Mr. Dharmendra, for hosting today's webinar. So thank you everyone for today's session.
Thank you very much.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you, dear.
Bye, Tripti.
Bye. Bye. Bye.